Okay, this meeting of the Reading Municipal Light Department Board of Commissioners is being broadcast live at RMLD's office at 230 Ash Street in Reading, Massachusetts. Live broadcasts are available only in Reading due to technology constraints. This meeting was videotaped for distribution to the community television stations in North Reading, Wilmington, and Linfield. The RMLD Board of Commissioners recognizes the importance of hearing public comment at the discretion of the chair on items on the official agenda as well as on items not on the official agenda. We ask that all questions or comments from the public be directed to the chair and that all parties, including members of the RMLD Board, act in a professional and courteous manner when addressing the board or responding to comments. Once recognized by the chair, all persons addressing the board shall state their name and address prior to speaking. It's the role of the chair to maintain order in public comment or ensuing discussion. At this time, I'd like to acknowledge our CAB representative, Dave Mancuso. Dave, thank you for joining us. And I don't think we have anyone else here from outside. So Dave Talbot will be our board secretary this evening.
I would be delighted to do that.
Thank you, Dave. We'd like to start off with our first item on the agenda, and that is a report on the public forum sponsored by the Town of Reading. And I think Dave Talbot and Colleen both have some comments. So
I was just kind of wondering, there was some email traffic about it and what it was about and where that all stands.
Okay, I wrote, good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
I did write an email. I did participate in that second meeting. There was a first one that I did not go to. I wasn't aware of it. The format of the meeting was various stations where they had architects there that were showing conceptuals, potential conceptuals of this area. What was a little confusing to me was that when I got the invite, the 230, the Ash Street buildings were not within the parameter of the study area. But when I got there, it was. I think there was probably maybe a little bit of a misunderstanding. I did talk to one of the architects. When you saw the conceptual drawing, it was a beautiful, you know, watercolor, but it kind of showed Reading Light over to the far right-hand side of this triangular piece. This particular building showed housing, a large housing units. Like apartment units or something, and then there was other commercial and a nice little park in the back. And what the architect said to me was that while the analysis had showed that this area was good for housing because of its close proximity to the train, at the first meeting they had said that they wanted commercial, so this was more of a conceptual of a mixed use. My only comment to the and I did much more listening than talking. So my only comment to the architect was, I told him I was from Reading Light, and Mr. Barbas was there alongside of me. Tom Alilla from Integrated Resources was there, and I just said that did he realize that we rented 44,000 square feet, which is an acre of inventory out back, which goes about 15 feet high in racks, and that we have over 51 company vehicles, and there's over 70 people that work here, and that's a pretty extensive amount of area. So when you actually looked at the physical area that was in question, RMLD takes up almost half,
right.
But I don't think they realized that.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
There's not an actual rezoning or development proposal or anything. This is an MAPC event, right? I'm just trying to understand what this event is. Phil, can you illuminate it?
I mean, it was a PUD or
Well, just a note that apparently the town has engaged the Metropolitan Area Planning Council to create an economic development
right.
plan. That was the June 3rd meeting that you were in attendance.
Right. So it was just more questions and answers. There's 9 owners in this area, and I think all 9 owners were invited to just talk. So those were my comments.
So, I mean, there's not a rezoning proposal before town meeting coming up in November, as far as I know, right, Phil?
Well, the next step for us is that we were not in sync with the town. So Gene Delios, myself, Bob LaLachere, and Tom Alilla and Jane are trying to sit down before the next meeting, which is in September, and also try to sit down before the next town department head meeting that I host, which is July 9th. So we're trying to make a meeting fairly quickly, and I can get more information to share with you as far as...
Do you have the exact date, Colleen, on the September meeting? Do you know when that
is? I don't have it right with me, but it is in my emails, and I can forward that to you.
Okay.
So there wasn't really any... It was more of a discussion type thing, and I just wanted them to realize... I don't think they realized how much physical space that we actually use in operations. And when you also consider things like you have to have radius turns for tractor-trailer trucks that come in and offload, large, the wire reels, some of them are 20 feet high. I mean, they're pretty big. So you have to have radius turns, and different things have to be taken into consideration for the operations. So, I feel like I'm glad to sit with the town and talk to them about, what it could be like back here,
right?
Where would we go, or we stay in here, or whatever. In addition to that, we're doing the facilities. As soon as we can fill that position, and we're still actively looking, facilities study for best usage of this building, Station 1, and the operations building, and hopefully consolidate, be more green would be. But until we find out, the state of Station 1. If there's any hazards in there, it's very hard to tell until we get the results. We also are looking at appraisals for the Barbas area and the parking lots in this building as just part of those assumptions that will go into that study.
Okay. Any other feedback from the commissioners?
Well, I think they certainly need to take that into consideration, because anything that we would do around that building, being it unloading of trucks or loading of trucks and anything else, would certainly impact any of the residential buildings, sure, that they would want to put up, because I can't imagine that'd be very interesting to a lot of people.
Mm-hmm. It's one thing,
wouldn't be very neighborly.
Right. Nope. At 3 a.m. in the morning to have these trucks unloading. Yeah. So and given that we're producing significant revenue for all four communities, I think we need to really make sure that they're aware that we have these needs for that asset.
Right.
Yeah. Well, I would say as a couple of action items, Colleen, you let us know in the next meeting. Is that open to, it's a public meeting on June or September or not?
I can't speak to that. Did get an invitation with an RSVP. I don't know if it was just the owners, but, there was
okay.
People
but you'll
from
be
the
in attendance,
there.
So you can report
yeah,
out
but
on the next
I
meeting.
Yeah, but I can find out for that. It may have been open, and then, they specifically wanted the owners to show up
right.
as well.
What's this next meeting again? What is it?
It's the next
follow-up.
It's a follow-up
meeting. It's an MAPC meeting?
Yeah. Yeah, it's a follow-up to the June 3rd meeting.
Uh-huh. Why wouldn't that be open to the public?
It very well might have, may have been. I don't know.
So I'm sorry, I didn't hear
why that. Wouldn't it be open to the public?
I think it probably will be open to the public.
It should be open to the public. Yeah. Let's put it that way. The open meeting law, it should be open to the public.
Right.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. So, Colleen, maybe we can find out just the date, and if it is open, if I assume that commissioners, if they have an interest in attending, would be open to do that.
And I'll report back in an email probably at the end of next week or the beginning of the following week, as soon as I meet with Bob and Gene.
I think that's, Mr. Chairman, I think that's the next thing to do is meet with the town and talk to the town.
Yeah.
Right.
If they've got people out designing this, for this building here, I find that rather unbelievable.
Well, okay. Somebody,
since they talked to us about, communicating, open communication, they got somebody out designing, on the building we've got here. I mean, that's great open communication.
I had told Bob and Gene, I had met with them a couple of times, and then Gene came down here to help with conversations with Mr. Barbas, that we were doing a master's facilities for best usage, that we wanted to be more efficient. So not to be misunderstood that we were vacating this building or we were studying all options.
Good. Okay, so we'll hear back from
you.
Thank
absolutely.
You, Colleen. The next item, so just a little background. As most everyone here knows, we have a member of the RMLD commissioners attend the CAB meetings as they do for us, and we thought a good practice going forward would be to have the commissioner who attended the most recent CAB meeting report back on any information that's appropriate or valuable for our information. So, Phil Pacino is attending the last CAB meeting. So, Phil, do you want to give us an update?
Yeah, I attended the June 17th, 2015 meeting. I was actually understudy for Dave Hennessy.
Good.
Okay. Thank you for filling in.
I think it was.
I'm happy to do the same. I'll do the same someday for you too, Phil.
A couple things that the major items that I'll hit. They did, which you're going to see later on, that we're asking under the power supply report. They did approve the rate changes. They did vote to approve that. And there was a very interesting discussion about economic development that was raised originally by Mr. Mancuso, who raised the issue originally, about, you know, maybe helping the towns, I don't know quite, you know, conceptually how we would do it, helping the towns in terms of developing, helping them foster economic development in the towns, with the idea that if we foster economic development, it potentially could lead to more revenue for us, which means there could be less rate increases as going forward, as opposed to potentially each year, you know, maybe a 1 or 2% increase. If there's more growth, then we wouldn't need those things. So, you know, it's an idea, and one of the things suggestion was made was Colleen is going to be in touch with the towns with a letter to let them know, you know, that we can help them in this area. Now, I don't know what the town, it'd be up to the towns, so it would have to be actually do with the economic development.
Sure.
It had to be the forefront. I don't think we could be the forefront.
Right.
But it would be them, and it was a very interesting discussion. It's the more I think about it after leaving and think to myself, you know, that's not a bad idea.
Yeah.
That's not a bad idea.
That's a little in line with what you've been talking about, Dave, for the last few years.
Sure. Yep. I mean, there's another tool that we can deploy in the toolkit.
Mr. Mancuso wants to add anything since it was his idea.
Yeah.
No, it was a group discussion. I think you did a great job, Phil. The idea is really try to address the communication issue that was pointed out earlier, right? As ever, the towns are looking to generate more revenue as they realize there's less state funding come in. In Reading, we've heard folks talk about how critical that is, and the initial thought was what we do is sell electricity. If we can help towns understand what an asset RMLD is and help them get smarter about how they sell RMLD as an asset and whatever their development plans are, not to steer their development plans, but to really empower them to be able to do a better job of saying, why do you want to be in our territory? And then maybe provide some guidance about where a good place is that if you were going to put a server farm based on the network and the grid, where would you put it? You know, to Colleen's point, you wouldn't necessarily want to put it some places. You may want to put it others, just like you wouldn't want to put us some places, but you may want to put us others. So mm-hmm. It was really just trying to figure out how to have that conversation. But I think Phil did a great job of describing the dialogue.
Good. Any more discussion or comments? Anyone?
So this will be something we'll add to the agenda on a regular basis?
Yes. Yeah.
Yep. Would you like to review the letter that I'm going to send to the town managers? You want me to just send it out?
I don't see a need, but...
I wouldn't mind looking at it. I mean, why not, you know?
Right. Well, if you have a comment, you got to send it back to Jeannie. Okay. But...
when would that be?
So next I'll probably do it by the end of next week.
Yep.
And it's, as Dave just said, it's going to address... You know, not trying to steer their economic development, but to just reiterate the benefit of RMLD, what it has to offer to the towns, you know, the services, the programs that we offer, and to just keep in mind that, you know, as they work with their economic development, that, you know, this is quite a benefit that only certain towns get to realize, actually. And I'll put in there that there hasn't been a new municipal since 1930? Is it about
1930? Really?
I will verify that date.
Well, there's a bunch that are doing telco only, like in Leverett and a bunch of other towns. But yeah, as far as
but municipalization of a utility has been, a lot of towns have tried to do it, and to no avail.
Isn't Devens, the old Fort Devens, I believe, is a municipal? I think that's the newest one that I think I'm aware of.
Well, I don't know.
That's state owned, and municipals, I think, bid to. To service it, to take care of it.
Yeah. Little Tech Services, part of Devens.
Yeah.
There's actually a couple of clauses in state law that would make it very, very difficult for anybody to start a municipal these days. Yeah. It's it really is kind of a golden goose that we've got. And
yeah, that is true. What I was saying, a bunch have started MLPs that only do telecom internet. They start them to do their own internet. Leverett and a bunch of Princeton, a lot of towns have started MLPs in the last 5 years.
So maybe we can work backwards and add electric to that.
Well, right. I mean,
absolutely. Yeah.
So this, but it's only a shell to do the telco.
A lot of state funding came in to help support those guys to get off the ground.
Some of them, yeah. Yep.
So, Colleen, you'll send the letter to the commissioners and put a response time when you need it back, because yes. I know you need yep. to get it off on a timely basis. Okay. Our next item, Phil is going to report as chair of our policy committee. Give us an update on the...
All right. The policy committee met this Tuesday. We discussed the travel policy, revision 8 that you have in, it's in the agenda tonight. With all the changes, we discussed it extensively. We made some changes, not a lot, to be honest with you. Some more questioning things in terms of that. And we actually recommended that the board adopt it, accept it. So I can make a motion, Mr. Chairman.
Yeah, I just add to Phil. So I think overall it was pretty tight. You know, there's also recognition from the commissioners that it doesn't mirror exactly the policies that you might have in a private setting, but overall I think it was consistent, and I think with a few tweaks it's a good policy. So okay, any other discussion before we have a motion?
Okay, Phil.
Move that based on the recommendation of the RMLD Board of Commissioners Policy Committee, that the RMLD Board of Commissioners approved RMLD's travel overnight / day travel in closing parentheses policy 5 revision 8 to be adopted as presented.
Okay, so moved.
Any discussion? Good. Yep. Are you all in favor?
A second, I guess.
Second,
we need a second.
Second.
Okay, second.
Second.
All in favor?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, motion carries 5-0. Okay. Thank you, Phil.
All right.
Okay, next on the agenda, we want to approve our board meeting minutes from November 21st and December 18th to bring us up to speed. So if I could have a motion.
One motion or two motions, Mr. Chairman?
I think one motion I think would be okay.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I'll move that we accept the November 21st, 2014 and the December 18th, 2014 minutes as presented.
Okay. Could I have a second?
Second.
Okay. Any discussion? None being had. We'll have a vote. All in favor? Thank you. So motion carries 5-0. Okay, next item on the agenda is our general manager report. So Colleen, we'll
okay,
ask
thank
you to
you.
Do that.
I just want to give a couple of updates. Next on the organizational reliability study, we had a good meeting the other night with the CAB, and both member Mancuso and member Crisos. Had suggested that we take all of the recommendations for both the reports, and even though they were at the back of the slides, that I would be allotted a certain amount of time to vet through what we are going to do and what we're not going to do. We did pay in the scope of the work to have them prioritized and timelined to kind of give us an idea of how much time they thought and what their priorities were. So we're going to put that together and then do a little presentation to say this is what we're doing, this is what we're not doing, this is why, what a narrative. And then we'll give you updates on those as we move along. And some of them we were already doing that, and we'll just give you an update of how that continues. So we figured in August or September, are we meeting in August? Are we meeting in August?
No.
Okay.
No.
So in September we'll do that update.
Okay. Colleen, I had a question, and we can take it, you can check and get back to us if it's not something you can easily answer. So my memory is the board had been given both presentations, but I seem to recall that we have a kind of it's almost an executive summary on the org
yep.
presentation, but not on the reliability, at least not that I know. I know we have a larger report, so I guess I think we presented it at two meetings ago.
Right.
But is that something we could get available?
Well, in both reports, in the presentation on the organizational, the last few pages with the purple blocks, yep, were all the recommendations.
Right. But I mean, I guess I'm, my, mine is a larger question on that. There's two reports.
Right.
One of them on the org report, I think we received the smaller deck because right, that was kind of a yep, synthesis of the much larger report.
Right.
But I don't remember getting that one.
We'll send you the recommendations yep, from the reliability
yep,
report.
Yeah.
You got a full copy of it, but what we'll do is we'll take them and we're going to yeah, put them in a chart so that they're easy to put on a presentation
right,
and then update you on
yeah,
them.
Okay.
That's okay.
Yes, that's great.
And the emergency, yeah, and the emergency ones have been taken care of. Some
oh,
of the
yeah,
some of the immediate electrical safety issues have already been
right,
addressed.
Good.
So.
All right. Any questions on the on that? Is everyone okay with that?
Okay. Then the next step is Leidos is supporting us for the completion of the career development plans for each of the employees, the salary evaluations, and the updated job descriptions. And there's over 70 people, so it's, you know, we got a good chunk done, but it's like the policies. It's a lot to do.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. So they're helping us with those going forward. I spoke about the list of recommendations. And then Leidos is going to come in with training on leadership skills assessment. And then we'll be creating the strategic plan. That will be the last piece on that.
Okay. Colleen, I have a question on that.
Sure.
Is Leidos delivering the leadership training, or did they talk about some other?
They outsource it?
Yeah, I thought they talked about somebody else, but I'm not sure if it's.
They subcontract someone that does an independent review.
Mm-hmm.
And I think they blend with the outcome of that. They have a company that that specializes in leadership skills assessment.
Mm-hmm.
But then the outcome of it will go back into the recommendations of, you know, what we might need for further training or whatever.
Okay.
But they're helping to coordinate. They're providing more of the, you know, the management training to try to make this process go through so we can get to the strategic plan. Because the way they said, it's actually the employees that will create the strategic plan, based out of these leadership committees that are put together.
And Colleen, just to, I guess two comments. So one, which we may have offered, so if there's any assistance that's appropriate from the board, you can let us know in terms of, you know, in terms of how you interface with Leidos. So if you have any calibration you needed, let us know. We'll certainly
yes,
be glad to do that. The other question, am I right in assuming that it's really based on the current organization, because I think we talked last meeting about the fact that any organizational design changes probably wouldn't happen this fiscal year just because things are in motion. Does that sound
well,
correct?
Well, no, that's why when I go, we're still vetting the org charts, and some
yep,
of the, some of the things absolutely make sense, and we're already moving in that direction.
Okay.
And some things might make sense. You know, this was written in a 20-year time frame, so based on succession planning, there's things that make sense right away. There's things that make sense maybe in 5 years, maybe
yep,
in 10 years, maybe when some people retire.
Right.
That's what we're trying to put it together in a more of a realistic schedule when you're working around all the unions and everything and who we physically have here and when their retirement dates are. But what we do, what the objective is that, you know, you have a certain amount of jobs in a utility that have to be done, and they
right,
all have to be covered. And people have to be trained to be able to do all of those jobs.
Right.
That's the objective. No more, no less. Just get those jobs done. So we just want to make sure that people are placed most efficiently and that they have the skill sets to do their job accurately and safely.
Good. That makes sense. Okay. Anything else, Colleen, from your side?
Nope.
Okay. Good. Any other questions from the board for Colleen? Okay. Thanks, Colleen.
Sure.
Okay, next we'll have the power supply report for May. Jane, you got that?
Thanks. I have two parts to my report. The proposed rate increase, I'll take that first, and then I'll just go over a few slides which summarizes the May purchase power. As we discussed with the board in May when we went over the operating budget, we talked extensively on the current 8 month actual, 4 months budgeted, revenues of base revenues of $21.4 million with increasing to $23 million for the fiscal year 2016. As we discussed at that meeting,
In order to achieve that, it's two ways that we're going to achieve that increase. Either increase in kilowatt hour sales or load growth or rate increase. And because of the flat to decline in our sales, we had discussed that during the budget process, RMLD assumed a 1% decrease in sales. So in order to achieve that $23 million, we'd have to have a base rate increase. When we discussed that, we spoke about the different rate classes, and depending on the rate class and the type of usage, that would average between 2 to 4% on average. When we looked at the rate increases, an average residential customer who uses 750 kilowatt hours per month would see approximately a 3.3% increase. And then a commercial customer, a large industrial time of use customer, who that increase would be around 2.07%. Again, so it fluctuates based on the commercials, what demand they use versus the total kilowatt hours per month. And on the residential side, it's basically their kilowatt hours. In meeting with our staff meeting with Colleen, one of the changes that we're going to make, because I do apologize, this probably should have been tied right to the budget because it was part and parcel of your decision in terms of approving the operating budget. So going forward next year, when we put these budgets together, for both the CAB as well as the Board of Commissioners, if any base rate increase is necessary, we'll have this portion of it tied to the operating budget. We think it's a much cleaner process that will allow us more time to advertise to our constituents of the increase. And so again, I apologize for not doing that, but we're always reviewing our processes to see how we can improve and make those more efficient. So what I have in front of you is the various rate classes that we have that would be applicable to that rate increase, and these would be effective on July 1st.
Okay, so would you like us to take that motion up now? Is that
please?
Okay. So I don't know if we also wanted to note that the Citizens Advisory Board met on June 17th and also was presented that motion. So why don't you tie it all together, Phil, if you would?
Moved that the Reading Municipal Light Department Board of Commissioners approved the rates MDPU numbers 250, 251, 252. 253, 254, 255, 256, 257, 258, dated to be effective July 1st, 2015, on the recommendation of General Manager and the RMLD Citizen Advisory Board.
Good. Can I have a second?
Second.
Okay. Any discussion?
I just have one question. Could we perhaps study for next year why we should or shouldn't just make the time of use opt out instead of opt in? So make the rate be dependent on when the costs are actually being incurred by the department. If people don't want the time of use, they can opt out. They'll be told about it with lots of warning. They don't have to take it, but it would make it so much easier if it was just the rate.
That for new customers, are you suggesting?
No. Why not just change it? We know that we're facing a tsunami, right, of peak costs. We've been hearing this for months, years. Why not just take a bold step next year? Now, not this, obviously not now. We have a whole year to think about this. And tell us why that shouldn't be.
Are you saying that everybody would pay that rate?
Everybody would pay the time of use, where they get a cheap rate from 7 to noon. I'm talking residential and whatever the industrial ones are, and that they'd pay the high rate from noon to 7. And again, opt out. You don't have to take it, but you have to take an affirmative step to not get the time of use. Instead of this battle that we lose, where we try to educate and we get a couple hundred people doing this, I'm seeing shaking heads, but I mean, why? Other utilities around the country do this. They actually, or in the world, do this, where the rate is different depending on the time of day by default.
Who's shaking the head?
I don't know.
I think from an administrative point of view, we would have to have service orders for 25,000 customers. We'd have to go out and change 25,000 meters because the meters are different from the a regular residential meter versus the residential time of use. So from an, it's not as simple as just clicking a button and changing
a rate. No, but I mean, but we want people to be on this rate. We're out there banging the drum, advertising it. It's on the cover of our mailings saying, please take this rate. So we want people to do it. It's on the cover of people's bills. It's on the envelope. So we want them to do it. Well, why don't we just change the rate and say, this is your new rate? And it could be done over a period of years, to your point about having to buy new meters. But if we want people to do it and it's economical for the department, why aren't we just saying, this is the rate? It's time of use now. If you don't want it, then tell us and we won't do it, so you won't feel the pain if you have AC running all day and you're elderly or whatever it might be. I'm just wondering. I mean, it's a big...
Can I ask a question?
Sure, Colleen.
Do you know what Braintree's doing with their time of use for commercials?
Yeah. Again, I think some of this stuff has to be studied. Braintree is now changing their time of use, their commercial rate, so that they're charging their customers the demand charge coincident with the system peak.
Okay. That's great.
In theory, one would think that would be great. However, we have a lot of customers who may not coincide with our system peak in terms of the demand revenue that we receive from that customer, because we receive the highest demand in any 30-day period, in the 30-day period in any 15-minute increment. So what happens is, I think it would be an actual loss of revenue for our department, but without analyzing the data. The thought, one would assume certain things without actually looking at the data. I would be very reluctant to just impose that on our service system for our commercial customers.
Okay, well, forget about commercial. Residential, that's the thing that's on my bill every month. It's saying, please take this time of use meter, please change it.
I think it's an interesting idea, and I think we need to look at the data to analyze it.
Yeah,
see what
I think it's that simple.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I mean, I guess it's a cognitive disconnect. If we're promoting it and we like it because it saves the department money, and it's on the cover of our bills, why aren't we just making it the rate and opt out? I mean, it seems.
I suggest we table it until we can look at it.
Yep. Yeah, I mean, it's not on the, it's not, there's no motion. This is just discussion on the rates and a whole year to chew on this and think, why wouldn't we do this? Or do it for some large segment and roll it out over a period of 4 years. If it's advantageous and we're promoting it now, why not just do it more forcefully?
Okay, is that something we can
study,
take a look at over some reasonable time?
Yeah, now we can get hourly data from the current meters, so we'd have to be able to analyze that data. But it will take a little time, but I believe.
Yeah, I mean, I guess my thought would be before getting into super number crunching, maybe it's an in-house discussion around, you know, what are the issues, because there's always it's easy for us because we don't have to do the work. But on the other hand, it does conceptually make sense. So maybe it's a conversation in-house around what's the advantages and disadvantages, because I'd hate to see us spend hours crunching it and arrive at a conclusion you might have come to just by having the team together and talking about it. But very worthwhile discussion, and maybe we can get an update at our next meeting, which is in September.
Can I, Jane?
Is that okay, Dave?
Sure.
I think it's a good idea.
Did you say for the residential, what would you give as the number one or number two reason why residential would not sign up for this?
I think it's lifestyle changes.
Okay.
I think, and that's what we face when we try to, you know, nobody wants to be told when they can do their laundry, or some people, I should say, don't want to be told when it's.
So then they can opt out.
Again. Yeah.
Under the concept, they don't have to. I mean, it's opt out.
Okay. What do you do about the non-educated consumer? Hmm? How do you address that?
Personal responsibility.
Well, you know.
You've been told what the rate is. You had a chance to opt out.
Offline, because there is an asset that we would have to buy more meters, install them, which is a service cost, and then we'd have this differential.
But people pay that back, $2 a month. Right. If you get the time he's ready, you pay an extra couple bucks a month, and you're paying the department back for that cost.
Currently, we have a clause in our, if they go on time of use, they have to stay on it for a year.
Right.
To try to control some of that administrative fluctuation. So again, I'm not saying we'll come up with some of the thoughts just as the board has suggested, and we'll get back to you in terms of.
That's all. I mean, it's all for a whole year, just something to talk about for during the year for next year.
I think as background, Jane, it would be good to understand, the a little more on what that means, time of use. I mean, I think we all have an idea, but it has very specific implications here and how we deal with our customers today. So that would be good background for us. So good. So we have that as a follow-up item. Thank you.
You have to vote now on your, because you had a second and then you did discussion and then I got onto this.
Oh, thank you. Yes.
Now we have to actually vote for the rates.
Oh, okay. That's a good idea. Thank you.
Right?
Great. Okay. So any other discussion? Okay. So we'll have a vote. All in favor? Okay. Motion carries 5-0. Thank you.
And then if I may.
Yes, please, Jane.
Just there's a couple slides just to summarize the May.
Oh, yes. Power summary, yes. That's right. That's okay. The second piece. Yes, please.
Attached in your packet, I've tried to put together, my group put together about three or four slides to look at May and to try to paint a picture of what actually happened in the energy market. I'm sorry.
Are they at the engine?
Just keep coming over.
Yeah.
There you go. I think that's it.
Yep.
Is it market statistics? Is that the
market
slide?
Market statistics. It's May 2015 market statistics. And what this looks at is the day ahead versus the real-time average cost for the month by day. And so this looked at the 31 days in May. As you can see, there was a slight spike on May 10th, which happened to be Mother's Day. What happened at that time, I'm trying to get a little more detail, but at hour 21 ending, which was around 9 p.m. at night, real-time prices went to $1,000. Most likely that was the result of either an import constraint or something, because it was just for that 1 hour, and then it dropped significantly after that.
Well, $100 a kilo,
$1,000 per megawatt hour.
So that's 10 bucks, it was translated to me to kilowatt hour, $10. $100.
You divide by 1,000,
Divide by 1,000.
Yeah,
okay. But as you can see, if you look at the average graph, the day ahead, which is the tan line, cleared around $25 per megawatt hour, or $0.025, and the real time cleared at $27. So they were relatively low. May's a shoulder month. There's usually not a lot of weather, so prices were relatively low for the month. If we look at this next slide, which looks at the day ahead market prices, and it goes back 2013, 14, and 15, the red line on the bottom represents the 2015, and that was significantly lower than the two prior years, 2014, which is in green, and 2013 in yellow. That probably has a lot to do with the price of natural gas. It's very extremely low right now, and we're able to take advantage of that. This is a typical graph which shows our resources by mix and our percentage. It's pretty typical. The one highlight that I would say is in May on the ISO market interchange, that average of $27, we purchased about 14% of our power supply from that resource. We had the Millstone and Seabrook units were online. Those, one of them, I believe it's Seabrook, is scheduled for a refueling in the fall. But it's typical load shape for a shoulder month here. And the final cost just looks at RMLD's energy cost, which is referenced in our entire portfolio. It looked at March, April, and May, and seasonally, April and May being the shoulder months, they've come down significantly. If you look at the March cost, was a little over 5 cents, and the May cost is it's under 4 cents. And so that helps us keep that fuel charge low to all of our customers in terms of the fuel charge, which represents about half of the power supply costs.
Okay. So the gas can be used for utility as opposed to residential heating.
Correct. In December, January, and February, New England is at kind of the end of the pipeline, and the ISO is working on infrastructure to increase that capacity to try to alleviate some of that prices. But someone's going to have to pay for that capacity if they do that.
good. Anything else, Jane?
That's
good. Thank you for the graphics and for including them in the presentation, which is very helpful. All right. Next, we have the engineering and operations report. Amit, I think we'll have you after your report. Amit, we have a number of motions, so we'll take those as well together. Then Bob can do the financials.
Thank you so much. Good evening.
Good evening.
The first page of the report, as you could see, is the capital improvements, the financials, which has categories, construction projects, new customer service connections, and special projects, / capital purchases. On the far right, you see the year-to-date spending on those. And on the first column, you see the percent completion. We're making steady progress on those. The next page is demonstrating the spending year-to-date, as well as the month of May on routine constructions, which for the month of May we spent $148,867, and year-to-date it brings it up to $1,678,130.
Excuse me. What page are we on?
It's further back in the.
It's in the back of the deck.
Do you want the overhead projecting to match what you're?
Yeah. Yep. The page one, yeah, that's the capital improvement projects. These are the list of the capital improvement projects which are covered under the first on page one. As you could see, there are. Okay, that's all right. The pole upgrades on Lowell Street, it says that, you know, we spent in the month of May $42,719, bring the year to date $160,000, which is 70% completed. We got the upgrade of the Linfield, the Cook's Farm, the Linfield Center. That's an underground improvement and upgrade. And that is 50% almost completed. West Street is forced account. This is the state project, which is almost 55% completed. And then we got the service installation for commercial, residential, and the routine constructions, which you see the year-to-date spending on those on those categories that on page one and page two.
Where is it in?
Right?
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Okay. The routine maintenance. Under the routine maintenance, we have the aged overloaded transformer replacement program, which for Padmont transformers, we've got single phase and three phase, and we've got almost 13% on the single phase Padmont transformers and 8% on the three phase Padmont transformers. The overhead single phase transformers, 10% replaced. The three-phase transformers of the overhead type, almost 3.3% replaced. The next category is the pole inspection, pole testing. 645 poles were tested for fiscal year 2015, and 390 passed, 233 they failed, 22 red tagged or condemned. All the 22, the condemned poles are replaced. 83 of the 233 red tag, the ones that they failed the test, they've been replaced to date. And some of the ones that they failed, we retest them again, just making sure that you know about the integrity and prioritize them for replacement. That brings the total up to 105 poles that need to be taken care of. And so far, 46 of those 105 poles that they either been replaced or the ones that they've been retested, they have been transferred and completed. So we got the rest to complete. The next category is the manhole inspection, the visual inspection of the overhead lines. And you see that 18 feeders, they were patrolled. And we found minor problems, minor branches on the vines around on the overhead wires, which we found and we removed them. The next one is the manhole inspection. And with the manhole inspection, this one is pending. We still haven't really got, to some degree, we have inspected the areas that we are making upgrades like Cook's Farm. You know, we are making progress on those. But the program for the rest of the town has not been completed. We still got a way to go. And the porcelain cutout replacement program with the polymer, we got only 284 remaining porcelain cutouts that needs to be replaced. 90% of this program has been completed. The next category is the substations. And the substations, we for the month of May, we did the infrared. We didn't find any problems. We also have infrared parks, the river park, analog devices, and Ballard Vale area. And we found a minor problem at analog devices, which we are taking care of the week of July 4th to take care of that and do the maintenance. This is part of the proactive maintenance that we've initiated. So that takes care of the maintenance programs. And the system reliability, Jane, can I put the charge up?
And the tree trimming is going okay?
Tree trimming is okay. Yep. Yeah, the tree trimming we have so far, we have completed 1,325 pole spans. And it's going really well.
Wow.
We doing the main roads and then the lateral taps, they come in the second priority as the main feeders and the switches are located on the main roads for transferring the load between the circuits, and that's a priority. And the system reliabilities, we basically monitoring three indices, the SAIDI, System Average Interruption Duration Index, System Average Frequency Interruption Index, and Customer Average Interruption Duration Index. And all of those, as you could tell, as you could see, they're all within the norm, and they're well below the national and regional averages. So we're doing very well, reliability-wise. Last slide demonstrates the chart, the pie chart, which says the cause of the outages. As you could see, still the majority of the outages, 37%, are related to the equipment, 28% related to the trees, and 23% related to the wildlife, and the rest are motor vehicle accidents, weather or unknown, or utility human error, which are very small portions of the pie. But we got programs, the maintenance programs, as well as the capital improvements that would address all these three areas. For the maintenance, the wildlife program we have in place, and trees that we continuously maintaining trees, and you know, and recently we actually extended the cuts from 5 feet to 8 feet, which we're going to start seeing some benefits hopefully moving forward. And for the equipment, also as part of the maintenance, the transformers that are being upgraded, as well as we got the capital improvement authorization projects that we taking the old stuff down, putting the new wires, transformers, switchings up, and that should improve the reliability even further.
Good.
So that concludes my report for engineering and operations. If you have any questions, by all means.
Board?
We could. Just one question, Hamid. Why is it so low in 2015? The total duration of customer interruptions is like...
Well, it's a good thing. Because
I know, it's good, but I'm just wondering why it's so low.
This year, so far, we've been doing so really great. I mean, the system is holding as we're making these improvements and, you know, the good maintenance program that we have in place. So that's been very instrumental, very helpful. We have replaced almost the transformers that they were giving us hard problems. Leaking, the old age, most of the ones that they needed to be replaced, they have been replaced. Mm. We still got a way to go, and we still got more that we need. But as we go through this process, you're going to see the reliability even getting better and better. However, I got to mention another thing also. These numbers are all of a sudden, depending on where the storm hits, you know, these numbers could be shifted, could go up. Yeah. So far, we've been really good, lucky, I guess.
Yeah.
We've had a harsh winter. We survived. But if the tornado is coming through the town, depending on where, you know, it hits, it could change these numbers.
Yeah.
So these numbers, the trend should be going down over time.
Right.
And that's what we monitor and we look for. And if it's going downward, that means we're doing very well. And then the way we capture the problems and see where we need to allocate money and spend the money in order to address the problem, it would be by this pie chart, which is telling us what caused those outages and what we should go after. Mm. And hopefully now with the GIS being upgraded and updated, we're going to be able to mark these and see where are the areas that these the failures are populated. And then we can attack those areas and basically address to specific locations. And then another thing that we're going to do, and this is down the road, when we have all the tools necessary with all the upgrades we do to the SCADA, outage management, and also the GIS, we're going to be able to do this analysis per feeder and see that, you know, which feeder it's hitting the most and which feeder it's experienced the most outage. And then we can even further down allocate money and spending and start capital authorization for either upgrade or do the maintenance, beef up the maintenance to address those specific areas. So everybody across the board is being treated fairly as far as, you know, the maintenance issues. Because right now we're only addressing the ones that they are in the red zone that they need to be taken care of immediately to avoid any more spendings on unnecessary spendings on oil remediations and things like that. We're still on that mode, trying to catch up, and we still got a way to go. But hopefully down the road, once we catch up, then that's going to be pretty much to the science that we'd like to get it to. We'd like to, where we'd like to be.
Sure.
Any other questions?
For Amid? Okay, so Amid, would you mind giving us a little background on each of the motions, and then we can
take by all note? Means. The first bid, I think you see that in the bid on page one, the RFP 2015-26, that's GIS/GPS field inventory. We send the RFP out with a template for the list of the attributes that we'd like to collect from the field to 42 firms. You have the list of the firms that this was submitted to them. On May 29th, 2015, we received the proposals, and the proposals were all evaluated. Out of those, we got four solid responses, which were real good, and one was good, but very it was really off the chart, to be honest with you.
Excuse me, Amit, so is sure. that are these in our package or not?
Yes.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. You know
this has got to be in your package.
After the financials. Okay.
Did you find that?
Oh, it's after the financials.
Yeah.
After, yeah. Financial after the financials.
Yeah, that's how the agenda is.
You yep. jump from 10 to 11.
Ah, so
Tom, go to the top. Yeah.
So what yeah. page is it?
Yeah, I get it.
What page is it? When you go back to the...
If you go back to the index, it's all page
yeah,
numbers.
In the index, it should
page
be 96. Under
page
30B 96. Index. 30B 96. Bit.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay.
Right. Yep. Everybody... You have them all?
I have it.
Good. Yep. So we got five proposals that they were worthy of really further follow-up, and, you know, we evaluated those five proposals that we received. The rest of them, some of them opted out due to time and resources that they didn't have available. So we got five good responses, and the range was from anywhere from $190,179.64 to $896,169.20. And the success were after further evaluations and reviewing their responses, we decided to award the bid to Davies, and the Davies came out to $395,434. And the base amount for this bid or proposal, I'm going to go over this. You have the chart for comparison. As you could see, there were two options that we requested to give us pricing on. There was a base option which included just collecting all the data from the poles and manholes, the underground, we asked for two options. One option was to prepare the data for MilSoft, and the other option was to take it on to the next level, like right at the meter base, to GPS those. So adding all of those three options, that brings it up to $395, $434. And that would be the recommendation to award the RFP to Davies for a total amount of $395, $434. The capital budget amount for this item was $420,000. So we are below the budget.
So Amid, the Davy was the only one that had a cost associated with the option with meeting?
No, actually, we had others also. They were all over. If you could see, Empower gave us the option for the MillSoft. But the MillSoft option on that one, it didn't include really the complete MillSoft ready to go to import into the software. That's the MillSoft is the software that we're buying for power flow and load flow analysis.
Yeah.
And
Do they have an option with meter?
No, they didn't have the option with the meter.
Okay.
Davies was the only one who supplied us with the options for the meter.
So effectively, that's what one of them.
And on this one, we believe the database maybe we think. That, you know, well, it's only maybe 60%, 70% accurate, but we're not sure. So I like to reserve that option to go that to that level. However, before we get to that and we start going that route, we're going to pilot test. Go to the pilot test to make sure that, you know, well, to evaluate our database.
Right.
To see that what percentage of those are coming out accurate. If they find the database is trusty, we can trust it. So we might not do that option. But if we find out discrepancies, as we found out in the rest of the GIS database, then my recommendation would be we might as well go through with it, get it all done so we have a trustable data source. Because that's going to be the basis, basically, for distribution management system, for MillSoft, load flow, for demand response, everything. It's GIS database.
Right.
And we need to have a good data set.
Any further questions? Okay, if not, we're ready for a motion.
All right. Move that RFP 2015-26 for GIS/GPS field inventory be awarded to Davy Resource Group, a division of the Davy Tree Expert Company, as the most advantageous, responsive, and responsible presenter for $395,434, including all options, open parens, parens, a MillSoft, and meter locations, closed parens, on the recommendation of General Manager.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Okay, any discussion? None appearing, we'll have a vote. All in favor? Okay, motion carries 5-0. Okay, next one, Amit.
Thank you so much. The next three bids are for transformers, basically. These are for transformer replacements program as well as the commercial and residential new services. So the first one is bid 2015-30 for three-phase pole-mounted transformers that we send it to all the distributors. And the most responsible bidder was Wesco for the total cost of $60,341. So I respectfully request to approve awarding the bid to Wesco for this amount.
Okay. Phil, you want to make a motion?
Move that bid 2015-30 for three-phase pole-mounted transformers be awarded to Wesco for a total cost of $64,341 as lowest qualified bidder on the recommendation General Manager.
Second?
Second.
Okay, any discussion? None appearing, we'll have a vote. All in favor? Motion carries 5-0. Next, Amit.
Thank you so much. The next bid is bid 2015-32. That's for three-phase pad mount transformers. And again, this is part of the transformer replacement program as well as the new customer installed services. So the successful responsible bidder for this bid was Wesco again for a total cost of $78,650. So I respectfully request to make the move to award the bid to Wesco for this amount.
Okay. Move that bid 2015-32 for three-phase pad-mounted transformers be awarded to Wesco for a total cost of $78,650 as the lowest qualified bid in the recommendation of general manager.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion?
Just a quick question. Sure. How many bids are we getting for these? How many people are bidding?
Oh, the list of the bidders are on the first page, as you could see. An invitation to bid was emailed to the following. We sent it to Power Sales Group, EDI, JF Gray, Power Tech U, PSC, Wesco, Yale Electric, Ward Transformer Sales, Robinson Sales, Gray Bar, Shamrock Power Sales, Jordan Transformers, and Stewart's.
So you solicited 12 companies.
12 companies we solicited, right. And out of those, the lowest responsive bidder was Wesco.
How many responded? Four responded. Acceptable bids came in.
Yes.
Okay. That's.
And you see the analysis.
Two acceptable bids came in.
On this one, yeah, two. That's true. We got Wesco and Power Sales.
And what happened to the other two?
On this one, I'm sorry, there were two only.
Two only. Why is it that only two people bid? I'm curious. I don't know how this works.
Some of the distributors, they can't make the time as we wish because we require them. Some of them have a long lead time and they're, you know, overbooked, so they're not providing.
They can't meet the requirements of the bid.
Yeah.
Yeah. We can't wait 46 weeks for a delivery of transformer that I have customers that they're going to go online in 10 or 12 weeks. So routinely we're soliciting these. The previous bid was two bidders again, the Power Sales and Wesco.
I'd suspect that companies like Wesco, which are probably tied to their manufacturing arm,
yes,
have an advantage over distributors who may not carry them in stock.
I see.
Yeah. And there are probably multiple reasons why. You see consistency in terms of some of these, which is a scale-related question.
Right. Okay. Further discussion? Not appearing. We'll go to vote. All in favor? Motion carries 5-0. And one more.
And the last one is bid 2015-33 for three-phase Padmont transformers. On this one also, the lowest responsive bidder was Power Sales for a total cost of $54,617. There were only five transformers involved on these. And I respectfully request to award that, to make the move to award the bid to Power Sales for this amount.
Okay. Phil?
And on this one, I guess, the three firms they bid, Wesco, Gray Bar, and Power Sales.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Move that bid 2015-33 for three-phase pad-mounted transformers be awarded to Power Sales for a total cost of $54,617 as the lowest qualified bid in the recommendation of the general manager.
Okay, second?
Second.
Okay, discussion?
Why were the other two bidders excluded? Because I noticed the other two are lower numbers. Why are they?
Because
so
either
they meet specific, or what did they not meet?
Either they don't meet some of the requirements that we put in as part of the bid. For instance, they need to have the bid.
There's actually notes there.
Yeah, the notes called out on the next page. Non-responsive bidders at the bottom of the page.
Yeah, bid bonds, Wesco
some
didn't
of them,
meet.
They don't put bid bonds. That's and they opt out on that because we require bid bond for that. And it says the bidding to Wesco, for instance, for bid 2015-33 does not meet technical specifications. That's one of them. The other one, Gray Bar, did not meet the dimensional specifications. So because the manufacturers based on. Because if we are replacing a transformer that it's already there, and the pad is large pad, and now the new companies, they go to smaller size transformers, so they have to make them bigger. That's a special design for us. So they don't do that, or they opt not to participate. So basically, that's why I let you know they don't qualify.
Okay. Other discussion? Not appearing, we'll have a vote. All in favor? Motion carries 5-0. Thank you, Amit.
Thank you so much.
Okay, Bob Fornia for our financials.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening, good evening, Bob.
And the financials start on page what, Bob? Do you happen to know? Have them there?
I don't have a tablet in front of me.
Okay.
72.
72, thank you.
72.
Yes, indeed, 72.
Page guy.
72.
Tonight I'll be presenting the May financials, which takes us through the 11 months of our fiscal year ending June 30. Looking at page 3, for the month of May, we had a net profit, a positive change in net assets of $800,000, thereby increasing our year-to-date net income to about $3.4 million. On page 3A, the year-to-date budgeted income was $2.5 million, resulting in net income being over budget by about $900,000, or about 36%. The actual year-to-date fuel revenues exceeded fuel expenses by $1.2 million, and the purchase power capacity and transmission revenues exceeded those expenses by about $350,000. Looking at the revenues on page 3A again, the year-to-date base revenues are under budget by about $340,000, a little less than 2%. The actual base revenues came in at $19.7 million compared to the budget amount of $20.6 million. On the expense side, page 12A, the year-to-date purchase power base expense is over budget by $400,000, or about 1.6%. The actual purchase power base cost came in at $26.5 million compared to the budgeted power base cost of $26.1 million. On the operating and maintenance side, combined, those expenses were over budget by about $150,000, or 1.2%. The actual O&M expenses came in at $13 million, while the budget expenses were at $12.9 million. Depreciation expense and voluntary payments to the towns were on budget, and those four payments to the towns were made in June. Looking at the cash section on page 9, the operating fund is at $9.4 million. Capital fund balance is at $5.7 million. Rate stabilization, $6.7 million. Deferred fuel, $5.3 million. Energy conservation fund is at $625,000. On the general information side, page 5, the year-to-date kilowatt-hour sales came in at $634 million, which is about $1.3 million higher than last year's actual figure, or about a quarter of 1%. Looking at the budget variance report on page 15, cumulatively the five divisions were over budget by about $115,000, a little more than 0.5%. And I just sent the created a graph just to show you the monthly breakdown of those of that budget variance among the five divisions. Just a couple of housekeeping items. This weekend we'll be doing the physical count. Auditors will be in on Monday to verify those counts. They were in this past Monday doing some field work, and that went well. The first week or two in July, we'll be sending out the accounts receivable confirmations to selected customers so they can confirm their balances to us. The audit is scheduled for the week of August 10th. So for the first 11 months and so far through the month of June, which only have a couple of more days, there are no surprises or anything that's being anticipated. In looking at the rate of return, we had budgeted for the rate of return of 6.8%. We're allowed to make 8%. Right now, and here again, depending on what the final numbers come in, we're probably looking at about a 6.2-6.3% rate of return for this fiscal year. So all in all, we're doing good.
Yeah, it's good. Do we have other
questions from the board?
Yeah, just are we going to have excess money? I know last 1 year we put money into the pension reserve. Are we going to have anything to do something like that this year at the end of June if we decide to do that?
We haven't made the actual payment. We budgeted $1.5 million for the contribution. Depending how the final numbers look, we'll probably fund the whole amount or we'll accrue some portion of that. We will be having another, every other year we have an actuarial study, evaluation study done. We'll be doing that again in FY16 to see what our liability will be or what our contribution should be.
Yep. Okay. Any other comments on the financials? Okay. Good. Thank you, Bob.
If I could make a request,
yes.
If it's at all possible, could we have the pages and the flow of whatever's in our package follow the presenters? Because we had to kind of go forward and back and forward and back trying to find where these sections were. So it'd be just a bit more efficient if we could. We know who's going to be presenting at what point in time. So can we just have the packages arranged so that they're in order? It's a small request.
Yeah, well, two things. One, I took it one item out of order because it was Hamid had two pieces that were not connected. But I think the other part of your comment is it sounds like there's a lot of information that is helpful but not to be presented in meeting. So
yes, right.
I think what John's saying, which would be helpful, if we're only going to present X, that if we could have X flow and then the rest can be behind it.
Could be in an appendix.
Yeah, right. an appendix, right.
That'd be fine. Yes.
Yeah, because on the one hand, we appreciate not having to go through enormous amounts of data that isn't value added in this meeting, but we also want to make sure we can get to it easily so we're not asking for questions and so forth. Is that okay? Yep. Good. Okay. Any other requests or comments from anyone on the board?
I do.
Okay.
May I?
Dave, you may.
At the last meeting, I think it was a very enlightening discussion around the new gas generator, and it's going to, a 2 megawatt peak, which is great. And as part of that, I think, if I recall, the numbers were that if we somehow wired up half of the remaining electric water heaters, we'd also get a 2 megawatt guaranteed peak cut by putting those timers on, something in that range. So I guess, and that would cost very little to do, and the challenge is only to identify who has them and approach them, if I'm not correct. So I guess I was wondering if the department could, I believe there are vendors out there who have software that can analyze load profiles and tell you which houses have the, or customers have the heaters, that could we maybe in September get a report on whether we can do a push where we ID them and proactively go out and do far more on that very successful program. Is that a feasible thing to do? I believe the technology's out there to analyze. There's a lot of very good analytics software that can look at.
They're out there and not hooked up? Are you saying we have systems out there that are not hooked up?
No, what I'm saying is.
For us to solicit or to determine who has the electric water heaters and approach them to add them.
Because as I recall, just to back up a little bit, there's an estimate out there that we have 4,000 electric water heaters in the district or something like that, of which 300 are under our program.
Yeah, we have about 600 devices.
Oh, great. Okay, 600. So there's another.
We have another 300 devices that we could potentially install.
But there are.
Correct.
Oh, we own the devices. Okay.
Correct.
But there's also 3,000 water heaters out there that are not controlled right now at all.
Well, we'd have to determine.
That we would like to do. But I'm sorry, am I misunderstanding? I thought that was the estimate, that there are.
No, GDS back in 2008 did a study.
Right.
And they estimated,
okay,
based on saturation studies, that there was the potential to have approximately 2,000 customers, depending on when the homes were built,
okay,
and what they installed.
Okay. So there's a credible estimate that there are about 2,000 additional water heaters out there that are electric that could be wired up.
2,000 total.
Okay, then I have this wrong because I thought it was 4,000.
I'll dig up the report,
okay,
and get back to you.
All right.
And what does the device do again?
It shuts out. It's hooked up to the internet. It's programmed to turn the water heater off for 2 hours. In the summertime, that occurs between 2 and 4. And then we have the ability to turn it off if we're going to peak a little later. And in the wintertime, that occurs more between 5 and 7 p.m. So but typically during the summertime, we don't have a problem because people are outside and doing things, so it's beneficial. We have had some calls in the wintertime because it's closer to dinner time or bath time for families with small children.
Yep.
And there's been a few instances where it hadn't worked for the lifestyle of the customer.
But the point is, if I understand it, is that right now we do reliably cut half a megawatt off, right?
Correct.
Because we have the 300 wired up now, we are reliably cutting half a megawatt of peak load right when we want it. Okay, so then that's data. That's actually happening. It's not theoretical. And there's another 2,000 or so, or maybe it's 1,500 water heaters that are in the district that are not, that there's an opportunity, right, to cut another megawatt or megawatt and a half.
Rather than try to intuit who's using the electricity, et cetera, because we could be wrong about a lot of things, is there a way to, and I support your idea, is there a way to send a coupon out that have, along with the bill, that says if you have an electric water heater,
they do that now.
Would you respond? And if so, we'll give you, I don't know what the number is, $20.
Well, it says electric water heater rate here.
To let us know that you've got the electric water heater.
Well, we've been doing that actually too with our, when we go out for residential audits.
Yes.
The vendor that we currently use, we have a form and they talk to the customers and they indicate, you know, what they heat with, whether it's natural gas or oil. They have an electric water heater.
Right.
So that we do have some data.
Right. So, but like all these other things,
there's no reason not to get the entire data if we're doing mailings to everybody.
Right. So people don't. The problem is that people don't sit down and read and react and fill out the form and tell us. So, what my understanding is, there are companies out there that can analyze your load profile from your meters and tell you where the electric water heaters are.
Maybe.
No, there are. There are. Yeah. I'm not making this up.
I'm just trying to make it easier.
Right.
I mean, what is it worth to us to have them let us know and put in the meter in the scheme of things for a year? How much do we save?
If we were to put that in, we could potentially save another half of 500 kilowatts.
Okay, but
more than that.
But in terms of dollars, I mean, in terms of dollars, what would the department save?
Well, again, going forward.
Approximately. Pick a number. Would it be worthwhile putting a
5? We won't hold you to it.
We won't hold you to it. What I'm suggesting is, would it be worthwhile putting a $5 bill in the envelope and saying, please mail this back along with your bill to let us know if you got it? It's just a survey.
Sure.
That might be a lot less expensive than using a survey firm who's using, I know exactly where you're going.
Right.
And some kind of electronic mechanism to tell when your spikes occur.
Right, or just knows what the bill, there's a lot of ways they can analyze the data, and they can see who has electric water heaters. Yeah. It's the biggest consumer.
I'm all for it. I think it's a great idea.
I just don't think we've ever done it, right? So
in totality.
So I guess I'm saying we know how much this is, the peak cutting is worth. So I don't know. What am I missing here? It's like the other thing.
No, we need to finish putting in the ones that we have in inventory. That's the first.
Yeah, that's a problem. So, Jane, could I ask you what's the consumer's cost in return? So is the device.
We get an electrician, we install the device.
Yeah.
So there's no cost.
It's free of charge.
To get onto the rate.
And what do they see in terms of?
They save approximately a little over $100-$120 per year by being on this rate.
Yeah.
So it is advantageous. We had some customers who didn't have internet, so that became a problem.
Yeah.
When we get to Hameed's new meters, we'll be able to achieve that. And so that will be a cross for those customers who do not currently have internet access.
Yeah. You know, like the earlier discussion, you know, maybe it's a little noodle time, you know, thinking about John's idea. Is it good? And I don't know.
It's a great idea, but administratively, it's a lot of work to coordinate customers' availability for there to be an hour to schedule the electrician to go out.
Yeah.
It has to get approval by the wire inspector. So, again, there's a lot of little nuances. We're happy to do it. We have the program. I think it's a fabulous idea. We just have to make sure we have the manpower and the administrative support to help with the scheduling.
I think where we're coming from is just what is the break-even analysis,
right?
Because to pay for that, to have it installed, plus the meter, plus the monitoring, plus the solicitation, it all costs money. I agree. And if it doesn't look like it's going to be a good payback.
It's significant, though, John, because, you know, next year our capacity market in the NEMA zone is going up.
Yeah, I mean,
you know, from $3 to $50.
We just voted the budget with a $2 million, right? Is it $2
million?
For the gas generator.
Yes.
So. Okay, so we just voted a $2.1 million capital cost to get the ability to cut a 2 megawatt reliably.
Great.
Okay, So this, we already reliably cut half a megawatt with 300 water heaters wired up. So what I'm saying is if you wired 1,200, you would have the same 2 megawatt guaranteed peak cut. And I would submit to you that it will not cost us $2.1 million to wire up 1,000 water heaters with a timer. It's going to be a lot less than that. Am I wrong?
Well, if it was $100 per installation, I mean, you're already up to, what is that, 1,000?
1,000.
Yeah. But then you have no...
The equipment, I think, is $300 per installation.
Yeah, so it's not...
All right.
Okay. Cost, but again,
so that would be that's $300,000.
$300,000.
Yeah.
And there's no... And
Let's look at the analysis. Yeah. Let's lose facts. Let's not...
Yeah. But then there's no gas. You don't have to pay for the gas.
I'd love to do it, but yeah. I don't have electric hot water heaters.
No, I know. Well, your colleague to the left does.
I'm ready to go.
So, I mean, this isn't some Looney Tune idea. This is like, it's
a
yeah.
whole other avenue yeah. that we can look at. Because
right.
there's water, we can go and install electric water heaters.
Right.
We can service water heaters. We can rent water heaters.
Right, right.
So there's a whole other niche...
But to your
power,
right, right.
Resources.
So to your point, there's 300 of these timers sitting in the Barbas building.
Correct.
Okay, so we've had these timers sitting around, and I'm just saying, why don't we hire a software company that can tell us which houses have the things, so that we can go out there and do it? Because my understanding is we don't know which houses have it. They're not surfacing and saying, give me the timer, right?
The new meters that we're installing, the right. system has that capability.
Right.
Analysis of this type, but with iTron metering, we don't have that capability. Another thing that I have mentioned that, you're right. Maybe if we go aggressively and don't knock at every door and, probably try to encourage more people to join the program.
Right.
But the people, they could opt out at any minute.
Sure. Right,
but
they can.
But if we distribute the generation, we don't have to rely on anybody that's already
right.
opt.
No, I understand that, but to the point
that's
of
the big difference.
Sure. Have any of the people who have them now decided I don't want it anymore?
Yeah, there's been a couple.
A couple.
Handful,
okay,
handful.
So it's not a big number that fall out. I'm just saying it's.
Yeah. So I think it's worth looking at, and I think, I'm a big proponent. Before we jump too quickly, I think John raised an interesting question. So how could we get information, what one is, you could hire a software company, you could put a $5 bill in an envelope. We could also put some advertisements in the Chronicle and, make a, that doesn't cost
$1 million.
We can
engage with the schools, get the middle school kids, I mean, there's a lot of things. We have a PR person who works for the department.
Yep.
So let's give the ops group. Right. Well, that's important. So, good ideas, not every idea we offer up is going to be feasible, but the fact that we...
But this one's proven because it's already working in the department.
Yep.
So
it's just how scalable it is given right now, and I think that's something they can come back to us on. So maybe at our July meeting or following, depending on workloads, you can let us know. It's important. It's not May Day, but just we don't want it to fall off the table.
Along with that topic, I'd like to commend the department for putting in a store, an RMLD store, where the light bulbs are being sold at, I believe, below retail price for LED. What's that?
50% off.
50% off, which is fantastic. So I think our community certainly should be made aware of that. With once again, as if it's in the invoice that everyone has sent.
Yeah. You're talking about an online store.
Online store,
yeah.
Yes, the online store, which was fantastic.
Why don't you put the water heaters on there for free on the store?
That's a good idea.
That's not a bad idea. It's another marketing strategy.
I love it.
Exactly.
Yes.
Do you have an electric water heater? We'll come put this in, and you'll save $120 a year. Mm-hmm. It's another opportunity.
Free with an asterisk. I love it.
Yeah, now that you have the store, I mean, why not? I mean, people are going to be going to the store.
So. Right. Or put something at Home Depot next to the electric water heater, retail display. People go and buy an electric water heater and learn something while you're there.
Okay. Any more discussion? Good discussion, good ideas. Any other information that we want to talk about?
Okay.
So we have an adjourned motion, Phil?
Well, are we going to executive session?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, we are. Yeah.
All right. So let me read the motion. Move yep. that the board go into executive session to approve the executive.
Oh, excuse session. Me. I apologize. I did want to make two quick comments. We have a July 30th board meeting, Thursday the 30th, and then we're off in August due to the NEPA conference, then Thursday, September 24th. We also, I think the policy committee meeting we still need to schedule, but we agreed that'll probably be in September where we're going to have a larger number of policies to be reviewed. But there's a Wednesday, August 12th CAB meeting, and we need, I don't know if there's anyone that's.
I can take prepared. That one if nobody's slated for it,
okay.
since I missed the last one.
Okay, great. Thank you, Dave Hennessy.
August 12th?
Yeah. August 12th, Wednesday, right? And I'm sure Gene will send a notice on that. Okay.
Ready?
In this room.
Ready.
Move that the board go into executive session to approve the executive session meeting minutes of November 21st, 2014, to consider the purchase, exchange, lease, or value of real property if the chair declares that an open meeting may have a detrimental effect on the negotiating position of the public body, and return to regular session for the sole purpose of adjournment.
Second.
Okay, discussion? Not appearing, all in favor? Okay, 5-0, motion carries, and meeting adjourned. And we will adjourn to our executive session meeting.
Indeed.
Oh, yes.
Aye.
Aye.
Yes.
Aye.
What if we didn't do that? Would the meeting just technically?